So welcome all of you to Design Media Arts, and I'm going to talk about my practice, which is in multiple disciplines and in various media. I am an artist, a designer, creative director, and of course educator here at Design Media Arts. Together with my husband, I have a studio in the North Village here in Westwood. And we do both. It's a practice in design and in art. And for today, I will focus on the art practice primarily. I think I want to begin with a couple of autobiographical notes. And I think the reason is because all of that continues to inform and guide me on what I do. It is interesting how a lot of the times, years after you have had those experiences, you realize how important they have been in your life. I was born and raised in Mexico City, and both my parents were trained as chemical engineers. So every question I had, no matter how mundane, no matter how trite, they would answer it from that scientist mind. And they would bring out the tome of organic matter, of organic chemistry, and the tome of inorganic chemistry. So that idea of the physico-chemical informs so much the way that I see the world. So they not only instill in me a love for nature, but primarily the idea of the passion for the nature of matter, of how things are organized, how things work, its systems, contraction, dilation of forces, so that whenever I would see then a mountain or I would see anything, it was less about its form and much more about the colliding forces that make these phenomena emerge. The second influence comes from living deep in the jungles of Mexico, especially the southeastern part of Mexico, where the whole family would be following my father's passion, which is Mesoamerican archaeology. So we would sometimes spend 1 or 2 months in the jungle, camping all the time. So it was inevitable to feel the presence of that jungle, to the noises, the intense noise of a jungle where at times you could decipher maybe the oscillating din of cicadas or the very, very low roar of the howler monkeys. But the main thing was that not only it was the nature that was very present, but it was also, you could sense, as times we would camp in between the Mayan temples, like this one is in Piedras Negras, that one is Yoquib in Maya, and it is in Guatemala by the Usumacinta River, but the idea that you were surrounded by these iconography as well as you were surrounded by the natural world, so that the vibrancy was not just of nature, but it was also of things, it was everything that was around me. So then my understanding of the natural world is twofold. One stems from this physico-chemical view, where I'm interested in the nature of matter, and two, the philosophical and political view of the natural world as vibrant matter. And I choose specifically that term, vibrant matter, for the title of my talk, which is the term that was crafted by Jane Bennett, which is a professor of political theory at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. As she explained in her book, Vibrant Matter and Political Ecology of Things, maybe some of you have read already the book, she aims to try to remove the distinctions between the dull matter, which is the it and things, and then the vital life, which is us and being. So I think that it encourages not to ignore the vitality of matter. And what I love about her is that she, of course, follows on the lineage of my philosophical guides, which have been Spinoza, Deleuze, and Guattari, and Henri Bergson. So this is just the beginning of a series of works in observations of this intertwining world of the built environment and the natural world, where all matter is chattering at once, it's oscillating, and perhaps even reveals the force of all things. This piece is a video I'll show you, and it's untitled by now, but it was captured in Mexico City this summer. And let me see how I'm going to do this transferring, because I need to escape from here, and I need to be able to go. And I know I am in a mirroring issue. Can I close that? Maybe there? Mm-hmm. Okay, and I'm too far to see. Is it there that it says sources? Yeah. Okay, and then here. I want you guys to take, oh no, wait a minute. I have them all open already. They should be somewhere in my, there. Which one is it? I can't see the icon. Let's try that. That's not it. I'm gonna open all of them because eventually I'll get to all of you, but all of them, but there. No. Maybe that one? No. How about the black one? Yeah, perfect. All right, so let's try this one. And this is just a clip of something that at this point, it has a duration that it is unknown. It might be very long, it might be shorter. So what I'm looking at in that work is basically the ways in which everything, again, oscillates, intertwines, chatters. And I think that I'm using that word to chatter because it, okay, now in how in the world do I get back? Let's see. I should have practiced this. Can everybody, can somebody point me? I see it. Then it takes me there? Oh, yeah, right. Don't need that. So just clicking on the right will take me? Okay. And like this, I have been filming just moments in this built environment where especially I see that there are things that come and go, that there are cycles to the performance of each one of these, you know, from the vendor to the car to the birds. And that again was in Mexico City. And I think that for some of you, I will begin at a very early stage when I started studying this kind of work. In each one of these work, in the works that I'm gonna show, there are things that I have kind of meditated on for a while that again informs to the next stage. So this is a series that is called At Any Given Moment. As you can read, they are immersive spaces of video, sound, and sometimes natural material. I capture in 16 millimeter film. I'll talk about the details of what, why that is in later on. And they are screened at architectural scale.
Thank you.
though they are just a continuous loop of the world. But the questions that I ask myself on this work is, why do living things and physical phenomena take the form they do? What are the essential mechanisms of nature? And I started thinking, somebody pointed me towards On Growth and Form of from 1917 of Scottish embryologist Darcy Thompson, Sir Darcy Thompson, who seeked for the unity of life and its relationship between form and function. He searched for a unifying design in nature. His thesis was that the purpose of designing living structures obeys engineering principles. Thompson declared simple explanations preferable to complex ones. He dreamt of defining organic forms in mathematical language, where the geometrical constructions, for instance, of a honeycomb, is proven to be governed by the operation of physical forces or mathematical laws. And right after that, well, not right after that, but in 2002, here comes Stephen Wolfram with a new kind of science that takes the legacy of Darcy Thompson and works it into the digital age, which, of course, this was already old news for a lot of you that work in this area. But he unleashed the cellular automata, simple computational, self-reproducing, open-ended mathematical rule sets. Wolfram posits that virtually everything from the patterns on seashells, the ticks of financial markets, even the universe itself, is a result of instructions as simple as the eight-step software program. Repetitive applications of simple computational transformations is a true source of complexity in the world. At the center of a new kind of science is the big idea that the algorithm is mightier than the equation. So in a way, he's kind of going against this complexity that Thompson was talking about, that it had to be a really complex equation that unified the world. And he's saying, no, it's much more smaller equations that are organized in complex organization. So those are the things that even as I'm looking at this installation, as I'm looking at the work, I specifically selected a very, very tight crop and a singular material, so we perhaps can focus much more on its organizational pattern rather than trying to decipher its components. So my understanding of the ecology presented here is not the Darcy Thompson unifying quest, but one in which it's not so smooth, it's not so harmonious, and actually it's very complex and diverse. The French philosopher Michel Sarrez said in The Birth of Physics, this deep ecology is a turbulent, imminent field in which various and variable materialities collide, congeal, morph, evolve, and disintegrate. So that messiness, that difference, that messiness is what, in a sense, I mean, if we think of the lineage of where these thoughts come from, even from the theory of relativity, where a lot of Bergson's thoughts are originate from, then we kind of, you know, can trace that back. And at any given moment, for one, this is a single channel video installation consisting of the screen, the projection that it's usually, you know, maybe 13 feet wide. Sometimes I've exhibited at 22 feet wide. And then the material, again, a singular material, that it is the other component that, in this case, it's 2 tons of lava rock. And sometimes at the Williamson Gallery, there were 3 tons of lava rock. This is Dettifoss, which is the largest waterfall of all Europe. And again, on this one, what I'm looking for is how the elements behave with the way in which my camera captures. And here's perhaps a good moment to talk about why the 16mm camera. When I want to bring the aspect of chance and change into perception, sometimes the perfection of our digital equipment, it sees too clearly, it sees too perfectly, it sees even much more mechanically than, or more, yeah, I guess the other one is mechanical too, but it just sees very different. It doesn't allow as much of the oscillation and the perception of the apparatus. I want to have co-collaborators the apparatus that I'm using is a really old Bolex. It's a crank Bolex, so that I cannot control everything, instilling chance, perhaps subtlety, oscillation, fragility to the apparatus. This is how it was installed at the Williamson Gallery, in which I was able to install it the way that I envisioned it, edge to edge, top to bottom, all the space. And what was interesting was that all adults remained on the fringes of the work. Little ones just immediately went into the work and started interacting and climbing the rocks, which I found that was, at the beginning, that was not my idea in terms of like, oh yes, this is for you to place, not your playground. But I think that that is the thing, that when you deploy something, that it's inviting. And especially to those who do not know the concept of, let's say, the world of art, which is don't touch, then the relationship to the work is very different. So again, I think on these works, I try to emphasize the work's particular organizational logic in time and space, and assemble a more compact environment, perhaps one that we can engage much more physically with our bodies, the relationship that we have to it. The cross-rhythmic tensions between simple elements, a blade of grass modulated by variable speed and variable light conditions, create visual difference and reveal the patterns that one simple element produces through the relationships of complex organization. The large-scale projection, with its engulfing force and meditative recurring cycles, enters into relation with our own human rhythms, resulting on a seemingly mutual modulation. When I'm in front of these phenomena, I want to be affected by it. Just the same way that moving to this country was a way in which I was affected by another culture and affected by another land and affected in a way that then it modulates me. I become this otherness. Sometimes I have thought that perhaps I have been here too many years. So much is so huge the world, so many cultures, so many differences, that to kind of add another difference to me is very exciting. Composer Karlheinz Stockhausen said, "We are all transistors in the literal sense. People always think they are in the world, but they never realize they are the world." As explained by cultural theorist Sanford Quinter, what Stockhausen means is that there are no phenomena in the natural world that do not manifest themselves as vibratory or rhythmic phenomena. Those vibrations attack us, they modulate us, and in the end become us. So here it is, an installation. The location was in Pasadena, and the fires in the canyons just outside of Pasadena had just happened. So for me, I saw fitting to then take something that was more of the area that not necessarily site-specific of the gallery, but site-specific of the land. And so we brought these truckloads of burnt wood into the gallery. What that does is that as soon as you enter, it addresses many more of your senses. And I always think of what Brian Eno said many, many years ago, when he said that there is not enough Africa in computers. There's not enough Africa in them, because they don't address so much of, they address so little of my body. And I think that that is something that stays with me all the time, because especially having grown there in Mexico City and the jungle, where you have this complexity around you, there is something about being able to sense the world not so with all of your five senses, not so much just the sight. I think the sight, it is privileged way too much. This Never Happened Again was a series that it started when I would go back to want to try to photograph a certain phenomena that I had seen, or simply that I was traveling and or walking, and then something was so magnificent that I had to stop and put the tripod and get ready, and it was gone. So this Never Happened Again focuses in the fleeting aspect of wanting to capture natural phenomena. When we capture, we stop its movement, we stop its animation. And so even if I try to create a simulation here, the reality is that it is another kind of presence of light, but it is not the phenomena I recorded. So this one again is also captured with a 16 millimeter camera, and again to achieve even a greater sense of change and to go beyond my control, I capture with this Bolix, the 16 millimeter camera, that it trips a lot. At times it just simply chokes on me a lot. So I began capturing just very, very simple things that were just outside my balcony. This tree, I wanted to be able to, through the idea of crank and shoot and crank and shoot and crank and shoot, that I would arrive at a bit of a sense of rehearsal, that it is the way of seeing is not just a one time and that is perfect, but it is the idea of many ways in which we can see differently, even if we are seeing the same thing again and again. So through this mechanism of chance, that it is introduced into the making of the image, the result is radiant chroma floods that intensified by the irregular flickering of the frames. And they are set against a very mundane nature, a grass, a field in the park, an urban eucalyptus tree, or cotton flowers. My interest in issues of perception expands into the perception of light by the apparatus. And what I'll do is I'm just going to show you frames of the rest of the works in the series. And the series is just simply called Never Happened Again, and then the location that I was in, Karanjukar in Iceland, this one, Glaciers, filmed in Svalbard. And again, is the idea of having the camera as my co-author. And I specifically put myself in situations where I am tested. My capacity to perform as a human being is tested. So here, when I am in a dinghy at 500 miles from the North Pole and surrounded by all this ice, it's snowing on me, and I'm still having to change the film, and I have to negotiate the atmosphere, I have to negotiate the land, I have to negotiate my body, I have to negotiate the weather, I have to negotiate the capacity of my camera. How many times I basically, was in tears trying to put together the sprockets. I could not feel them, and yet it somehow opens my understanding of this idea of the vibrant in matter, that everything, the ensemble of all of the elements, is what creates an artwork. So this is the way that it is exhibited. This has been exhibited at the Hammer in the cafe. It has been at the Nevada Museum of Art and the Municipal Art Gallery. So it also adapts to whatever space there is. I'm not someone that, if I film with exactly a certain level of frames, of pixels, that it has to be that. No, for me, it's more creating the experience that, the immersive experience that you're in. Nothing further happens, again, single channel work, that the sound is composed by Ben Frost, who some of you know, shot in 16 millimeter. And this work focuses in another area of investigation that I'm passionate about, and it is the idea to explore the concept and the feeling of the sublime. Immanuel Kant said that the sublime was not so much a formal quality of some natural phenomena, but it is much more a conception, something that happens in the mind, and specifically on our idea of limits. And in order to clarify the concept of the feeling of the sublime, German philosopher Schopenhauer listed examples of its transition from the beautiful to the most sublime. Where the fullest feeling of the sublime was the experience of the immensity of the universe's extent and duration, and that there was pleasure from the knowing, or from the knowledge of the observer's nothingness and oneness with nature. This next sentence in my talk is in Spanish, so I am going to actually translate right now because I just gave this lecture in Mexico. But the philosopher Lyotard, he said that the sublime, it is actually the expression of our conceptual powers, and especially it reveals the multiplicity and instability of our postmodern world. So that idea of the technological sublime, which of course we experience it at all times. And as I traverse the world documenting the forces of nature, I hope that there is that concept of élan vital developed by French philosopher Henri Bergson, who he described as the explosive internal force that life carries within itself, which he claims animates all being. And as you saw, in a way, as you know, the experiences that I had as a child and the worlds that I inhabited as a child, I continue to perhaps seek that experience of feeling everything around me oscillating, vibrating, chattering. Whereas in the Arctic, it feels that nothing out there wants you to live, because if you fall into the water, you know, they basically tell you that you have six minutes to live if they keep you in the water, 3 minutes to live if they take you out of the water. The same way in the jungle, I mean, you can just walk into a nauyaca, which I don't know exactly the term of that snake in English, but it's the one that just bites you and you die. So what is it about that sensing, the ending, the possibility of the ending of your life, that it makes, at least in my case, feel more precisely that my nerve endings are much more alert? And it's not that I want to die. On the other hand, I remember very much a conversation that Deleuze had with Francis Bacon, the painter. And he said that, you know, Francis Bacon, it's said that you know, he's morbid and all these horrible things, and there's a lot of horror in his paintings. And Francis Bacon said that, you know, I might be cerebrally pessimist, but I am nervously an optimist. And I think this idea of the nerve endings, having that optimism in a sense of the life within, is something that I keep thinking about. And this is a little bit of the work.
Thank you.
there's a lot of more work, and I didn't want to like there. So then the idea that traveling and the journey as a medium in itself is something that I consider a lot. What is it that, as I'm traveling, what kind of ecology I am joining? What kind of worlds am I being part of? What kind of what is it required for me to enter into these worlds? I created this series, Weatherscapes, which I will go very fast through because I want to focus much more on the idea of walking or traveling through the land. But this photographic series focuses, again, it's like the idea of putting myself in these situations in the natural world, that it just allows me to be able to awaken heighten my level of perception. Some places, for example, here, the Arctic tundra, which is completely the opposite of the jungles that I grew up with. Some people ask me, like, why do I go to these places? And it's because this is the unknown to me. Whereas the other one, it is so familiar that it feels very much like home. This is something that it is another world, and I am feeling this openness and the possibility of the world anew. So this sensation of being surrounded only by completely like vast horizons in a complete surrender to spatial infinity. And again, this Weatherscapes, with the series, I explore the numbing phenomenon of flight and void, which places us at the edge of the amorphous infinites. So perhaps this is the one that exemplifies the work the most, of that specific kind of work, this almost idea of the whiteout, in which the idea of the space is dissipated. And here is where I began to be very aware. I mean, I have to say, in Los Angeles, we don't have enough weather to actually consider it. And I do travel to all these other places because I enjoy the way in which weather inhabits the space with me and creates a different kind of space. So here, for example, fog, rain, snow, clouds inhabits the otherwise vast abstract space between my body and the distant horizon. I then experience a more compact environment, creating a continuous and intimate ensemble between my body, the weather, and the landscape. We have, in a landscape, we usually, or a seascape, we have the dichotomy, clear dichotomy of one and the other. Philosophically, this work began to just work to try to make that into a multiplicity, a landscape of multiplicity, where the gray or the, there was no line dividing this or that. And you will notice that throughout the work, there is always kind of an underlying word that it is and. Just this idea that it's always this and that, that the cacophony happens in the and, not in the or. So it is, in a way, I grew up very much in a dichotomy, black and white. So it is a meditation to try to perhaps correct that. And that is a very kind of a personal meditation I work with. So again, going to walking. The French philosopher, and you will notice that I'm almost quoting only French philosopher or very kind of like German philosophers, but we'll see. It's like French philosopher Michel Descarteau, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, argues that the practice of walking is analogous to that of speech, the speech act, and can also be understood to create a kind of spacing, a syntax in relation to how things are encountered. Walking and travel are described as a form of enunciation that carries the possibility of breathing life, introducing a temporal beat or narrative. So this idea that what you observe, that which is how I traverse the world, is a narrative, is a syntax, is something that I've been fascinated with, especially when I came to this country and language was not my friend. I could not express myself at all. I thought I understood English, but there was no way that I actually could sit with young people because I knew the English, the formal English. I think old ladies were great to me. They spoke so slow to me. But so then language became secondary to my way of understanding what humans meant and what the world meant to me and what my place in the world was. And so a lot of these then being able to inhabit the world through then in the walking or through perceiving it through my body is my entrance to the world. So recurrence relation is a series that I'll go very fast through, but it is one that it was the first attempts in beginning to do works around the idea of walking. I called it recurrence relation mainly because it was to be said in a loop, and that I know that every time that I would see the work, I would think of it very differently, as if the previous time that the cycle had passed, it changed the way that the next one was perceived, therefore being a factor in the equation. Recurrence relation zero. I simply for a long time didn't want to deal with this one because it was very shocking to me. It was basically, it happened at in Bolivia. I shot it with 16mm. The film broke, and only about 3 seconds of it, maybe less, 2 seconds of it are left. These are some of the frames that came back. What happened was that without Adam and I knowing, we were in Chile, we took the off-road, I drove it into towards Bolivia, and we found ourselves in a minefield. And so that was something that the reason we learned there was a minefield is because there was a sign that had fallen, and it was all weathered signs. So Adam, I had told Adam to go as far as he could and for him to start walking. And then he started walking, and when he arrived, he had this horrendous pale face, and he just said, "We are in a minefield." And so I begin researching that, and I'll read you something that was in the newspaper, but it says that the dictatorship of El General Augusto Pinochet laid hundreds of thousands of mines along Chile's borders with Peru and Bolivia in the 1970s, when it feared invasion from the north. Chilean army bomb specialists on Saturday pulled what was left of a Peruvian taxi out of a minefield, where at least one person was killed in an explosion the night before. So unfortunately, and that was 2012, we were there, oh, I don't remember, 2008 or something. So they haven't been able to clear a lot of that. So it made me think about the precariousness of walking through land that it is unknown to you. And so the next one was really being in Moffin Island. This is past the 80 degree parallel, where I take my subject to a walk that it is from as far as possible, and at the same time knowing that there is that risk of the unknown as she goes in to perform the work, and at the same time as I record it. This is in Spitsbergen Island in Moffin Island in the archipelago of Svalbard. So I won't pass the film of these. You have a sense of what the work is. And then the last piece of this, I thought, here we are, the scientists, the artists, in this artist residency where I met Jane. So I think that was where our relationship began. And I'm very curious about then, how is it that these scientists live in this environment? What is it that, obviously they're doing scientific research and they are, they're coming back, they're establishing periodic rhythms in their travels, not unlike the migration of animals and birds. So then the idea of beginning to document scientists at work began to be a next project that I started working with. This is in four because this was exhibited at a gallery that was 100 feet long. So four projectors were composing this work. And then this is again the idea of walking and where I have filmed myself going through, a lot of different landscapes, and I created this work that is going to be only, it will end when I cease to exist. I want to be able to record myself walking the earth. It's, the work is called Walking the Earth, so that I'm walking and walking and walking through my life and through time, and just understanding again the story, the words, the syntax, in a sense, of my pathways. In the same way, I am looking at the idea of circumnavigating islands, and this is called circumnavigating. So circum, really going around and understanding the idea of the island. So again, I am going to escape from this one. I'll show you those two works, and then I'll return. I think that some of them are behind here, aren't they? Okay, so this one. So at this point, it is in this circular mask, and it is mainly because it's the focus. I created this work for the work that I'll show at the end, that it is called Circumsolar Migration 1. The idea of this walking is that it could be installed in any way, in which each one of those landscapes is about 40 minutes of filming, where the landscape exists for a long time, and then only for an instance I walk through it. So the landscape exists on their own, and they are aligned in a room 380 degrees, and it's just I am walking around the room in the landscape. So you get the idea of that work. And then the next one is the island. And again, the island, I am fascinated by, where is it? Arctic, yeah. By the idea of being able to know and to surround. It's a little bit that is as I'm walking, I'm understanding, I am mapping. I'm not doing the cartography, but I am doing a mental cartography. I am getting to understand that landscape, that seascape. And again, here is the point of view. Where is it that I exist, that I'm able to actually then understand this in ways that otherwise, if I am on land, I have not the place, the perspective, but it is also gaining the distance in this work. As coming from Mexico City and arriving into this culture, I really felt very isolated and very much like an island. I think that it is one of those aspects of the immigrant, in that you come into a culture and for a long time, this is who you are, this is how you exist, and that you can begin to establish bridges, and that you begin to go into a boat maybe a little dinghy and go into another place and begin to discover connections between these islands. But I think that the concept of island remains in me forever, which is a beautiful concept, a beautiful sense of understanding location. So this one, I am in a boat, and you saw me cleaning the lens. And I'm doing it with a 16 millimeter, just a frame by frame time lapse. Okay. Okay, and I think that what I'd like to, the following projects are more the current practice that I have. I mean, it's always, I'm doing always many, many things at once, from poetic moments like the island, I consider that more like a poetic expression, in contrast with, you know, 10-year-long project. I like shifting from one mind to the other. So my current practice is could be understood as field work. I'll read you something here. Robert Smithson notes that there are two types of scientists, the one who has the control studio experiment, and then the field scientist, who is working in a sense with the uncontrollable aspect. And that the conflict arises from the perfect isolation as opposed to the chance disruption. The security that comes from working in a lab is very similar to the security that comes from working in the studio as an artist. So there is a parallel here. The studio and the lab become places where you can control your information, but at the same time, the information you are controlling is not that interesting. The stability of that is constantly challenged by the instability of these extra forces, like, let's say, the weather. So I think that that is why, to me, it became very, well, I think forever, since my father would take us to, you know, pack us in a Volkswagen van and just cross almost the entire Republic, Mexican Republic, to be able to get to our destination, exploration became very important, especially because he would follow the John Stevens and Catherwood books from the 1800s to be able to get to his destination. They were destinations that he would just say, well, in this relates of Yucatan, I forget the title of the book. He said that if you would go to the Pueblo de Santa Elena, you talk to Don José Pérez, that he'll take you to caves where you actually would see the shrine towards Chuchac that had about 300 pots, stories like that. Well, my dad would actually go to the Pueblo de Santa Elena 150 years later, and oh no, I think he must have, I don't remember the years, 100 years later, and he would go to the cantina and ask for Don José Pérez, and guess what? The fifth or tenth, whatever generation of Don José Pérez will take us to the cave. So this is a very interesting understanding of time, that actually you can still in Mexico find that lineage, that that history exists. So that idea of the expedition is instilled in me, and that is why the field work makes sense. So the Arctic Circle, I think that I bring this up because it is what triggered my idea of working on a long-term project. In 2010, I traveled to Longyearbyen, the largest city in Spitsbergen Island in the international territory of Svalbard Archipelago in the high Arctic, to join a group of international artists, scientists, architects, and educators on an Arctic expedition. And I think, Jane, there's where you went as a scientist, as the engineer there, which was great. It was organized by the Arctic Circle, an annual expeditionary residency program, participating in a three-week residency program aboard the Norderlicht, a two-mast I-class sailing vessel, ta-da. We collectively explored one of the most remote and unusual places on Earth, where not only there are more polar bears than humans, but at minus 25 degrees, that it seems that nothing out there wanted us to live. So at the same time that we are in this kind of fairy tale, because there is something about that, that it is the ideal of the vessel that will take you to an expedition, you know, we are having to move the vessel because these creatures are love to puncture zodiacs. So we're needing to find the current, the right moment of the current. What are the ways in which you will actually survive that place? Thinking in terms of what as a, the difference between going and in a more idiosyncratic kind of travel where you're following scientists or where you're following birds or where you're following something, versus knowing that you will hop into a, you know, cruise liner and just go wherever the cruise liner goes. Those are two differences in travel. The travel that I enjoy doing and that I'm doing in my research is to actually then, you know, begin to follow, like in this case, how is it that scientists live? What is it that they how is it that they inhabit this inhospitable land? So these began the photographic work in Nialisand, which is the northernmost functional public settlement on Earth. It's above Siberia. North of Nialisand, you can only find a few trappers. So again, this is about these photographs focus on the habits of migrating scientists. So in this case, scientists from Norway, the Netherlands, Germany, UK, France, India, Italy, Japan, South Korea, and China come to Nialisand to do their work. There was a building that was called Mexico. And I go, yeah, right. Do you think we are going to, I mean, do we care about actually exploring the pole? No, it was just the idea of warmth that they called it Mexico. So in case that somebody was going a little mad, they could find a bit of respite. So these scientists, again, is like they remained, sometimes they remained there for a couple of years, and then they returned to their respective countries. And as I mentioned, they journey back and forth dozens of times in the course of their scientific investigations, establishing a periodic migratory pattern, not unlike animals and birds. That began to fascinate me. Already then we were beginning to explore and to investigate a bird, the Arctic tern that I'll tell you about. So it was also about journeying, but it made so much sense to then focus on the scientists that they also journey back and forth through their research, doing their research. So these images are part of a series that I call Circumbipolar. What else? So it was not only then the scientists, but of course its context. Where is it that they're inhabiting? And this is the second series of that work, and this one focuses more in a coal town that is called Barentsburg, also in Svalbard, but this is a Russian town. The title of this series is called Barentsburg, Svalbard. So Barentsburg is a settlement, a Russian settlement in Spitsbergen, again, which is coal mine, and the coal mine was very, very unsuccessful. It was good at one time. Maybe they had a couple of thousand inhabitants, but now they're even down to about 200 inhabitants. Nobody wants to go there because also the coal mine is not producing almost anything at all. But it is very important for Russia to maintain a footing in Barentsburg. Seems to me that right now they're changing their attitude and making it more like a tourist destination as, of course, the Northwest Passage opens and the Arctic begins to be a place for vacations, then they are going to do that, which will only, of course, accelerate all of the climate changes. So these are some of those photographs. I'll go through them. The juxtaposition to me of this very, very Eastern Bloc building against this completely barren environment, it is almost abject. There's something so incongruous about it. And especially the soccer net. And I found interesting the way that they utilize painting and these kind of ideas of a mural. Right as you enter the coal mine, it is this beautiful forest. So that through their paintings, through their artwork, murals, they help themselves inhabit and maybe negotiate relations to their habitat. In 2007, a Russian member of parliament and explorer, he went under the ice cap in a submarine and planted a flag at the bottom of the sea. And of course, this was a statement, of this thing will melt, and what I care about is the resources that are underneath. So this following work is my response to that work, or my reaction to that work. Oh wait, sorry, I think I need to. this is what I do. No, I think it is going up. So issues of the difference, or like the way in which space can be transformed into place, are important for me. The way in which culture, the way that you inhabit a space, you make it be a place, and what are the subtle gestures that one can do. Issues of identity come, of course, in play here. What is a political identity? What is a national identity? How does that play in relation to expedition and gender in expedition and conquering? The worst is that we continue to treat, I mean, this imperialist kind of mind, this conquering mind, should have been gone a long time ago. It's something that it's not appropriate for our world. And at the same time, it seems that it is as it is as aggressive, the desire to continue to not only conquer, but disrupt territory. So of course, the futility of the conquering is important, and the fact that of course you can't do that. You can't. So anyway, the piece continues. I go to the other side, I go back, pick up the flag and leave, because there is still that oscillation of what is my identity? I'm left with none. Can I live with none? Can I actually live in that moment of becoming where identity is not present? And that's how it's done. Then these are, I think I'm going to go very, very quick through this piece because I know we're running, I mean, I've been talking for a while, but the other works that were, there were three works going at the same time, or four works. It was the overall investigation of the idea of migration, two public artworks that dealt with two public artworks, and then a work that was exhibited at GLOW. So that was the culmination of some of the research that I was doing on the Arctic Turn. So I'll go briefly on this. Strangely enough, this is opposite to what I've been doing. The only true voyage of discovery, the only fountain of eternal youth, would be not to visit strange lands, but to possess others' eyes, to behold the universe through the eyes of another, of 100 others, to behold the universes that each of them, to behold 100 universes that each of them beholds, that each of them is. So as I am asked to do a public art in a library, it made sense for me to kind of bring this idea of travel through the way in which we can travel through what the library offers, books, films, everything, even conversations. So I created a mural that roughly just basically goes from the Arctic to the Antarctic, and it moves through the parallels, and it moves through land, centering Pico Rivera, where this mural is in the library, in a place where they had these incredible wetlands. It is the spreading grounds that for a long time was abandoned by, were abandoned by the city, and because, not by the city, but by people, they didn't let people go in there. It became the most beautiful sanctuary for birds. You have our Arctic tundra going and migrating there. You have birds from Brazil. So then it was a way of being able to put a city that it is 99% immigrants from all Mexico, Latin America, and South America in the map of trajectories of flow. That rather than being isolated and alone in a place, it actually now belongs to the rest of the happenings in the world. So the mural, blah, 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 it just goes through different places, and this is just very briefly what the construction of the mural was. and again moving through different biomes and different kind of, you know, territory. It was printed on fire retardant canvas and then adhered to the wall. And where I wanted to kill the architect. He was very nice in many ways, but when I know that this, which is one of those things that I just felt is like, there, I don't think I will ever do an artwork that actually is on the wall. Because when I was working with Tom Main, there was a clarity, there was so clear in my public arts before that that was an artwork, it's not wallpaper. And I think unfortunately for some architects, then that becomes wallpaper to actually destroy. So I was quite furious. This goes through how then bookcases and all kinds of things were in there. And it simply, for the people of Pico Rivera, it gave them a sense of extending their city, extending the purpose of their city beyond their territorial limits. So in a way, it's a kind of mapping. And then the next work is another commission, art commission, that it was commissioned by the, both of them were commissioned by the Los Angeles Arts Commission. And this one is an observation post. And the idea for me was that in libraries, especially young people, it's very hard for them not to just look at their shoes or their phone. So I wanted for them to just simply look up. And this work is inspired by bird watching towers, which I am working on a series of bird watching towers, which I called observation posts. And this is the idea, very simple, of the observation post, is that you sit to frame your mind, and that you then, the moment that you concentrate, you begin to perhaps daydreaming, to daydream and to imagine. So again, fostering imagination. They wanted this piece to last 100 years, 200 years, 500 years, and there's something that you need to think about in terms of public art, what actually will be there forever. And so I use cort and steel. It's 9 tons of cort and steel. And at the lintel, I have the quote that you saw before. So as you are looking at the work, it casts a shadow, so you're able to see a texture. You cannot read the text, but you're able to then look up. And perhaps as you look up, then you see that you have the beautiful trees are there. It's perhaps in that area, one of the nice things that they have is the top of the trees. And they have gorgeous trees in that locale. And the rest is just simply to frame one's mind, to frame one's thoughts, to contemplate. The letters were water jet. The cort and steel is 1 inch thick. And the idea was that all around it, it was going to have drought resistant plants. So something that you wouldn't have to water that much. But Gloria Molina wanted grass. She is the incumbent, the person, you know, in the district, the word. So therefore, we got grass. And what started to happen was they needed to water the grass 3 times a day, and therefore the work started to corrode at a pace that it was ridiculous. So they, of course, don't feel like they can go back to the city, to the district and say, well, we don't want your grass. So they wanted to try to have us redo the work, aspects of the work. And, you know, we're basically, when this is the kind of thing that in public art is difficult, because you then have to be so clear about where your edges are. And we said, you know, the work was approved when drought-resistant grasses were around. So we did our work according to that plan. That got changed without us knowing, and then it is then the problem of the either, unfortunately, perhaps the Arts Commission or the city itself. But those are things that, as you're doing public art, It's interesting to know where the edges, the, when you have your contracts, you'll, those who are interested, a lot of learning to do in that area. So Circumsolar Migration 3 is a piece that is installed right now at the Elise Williamson Gallery. I know some of you already have been able to see the work. But this is one in which, I'll just read you the text I wrote there. Sometimes when I read, maybe I'm more concise than telling you stories. Circumsolar Migration 3 is a contemplation of migratory seabirds captured during their breeding season at Latrabjarg, the westernmost point of Iceland, which is the largest bird cliff in all Europe. It is 14 kilometers long and up to 440 meters high, hosting up to 40% of the world's population of one species, or a given species. At any given moment, be it day or night, there are great migration, great bird migrations taking place. Ornithologists estimate that more than 5 billion birds annually journey across the hemisphere. And what's, to me, wonderful about this is that even greater than the complex weather systems that we consider to be the greatest things that, that we have, bird migration might be the one unifying natural phenomena in the world. So, formally, the video image, I chose to turn it around to do it vertically, so that the boundary dividing the sea and sky becomes a little bit more unstable, even blurred, and the spatial shift together with the low video frame rate furthers this abstraction so that maybe we understand the migratory impetus as code, a genetic code of evolutionary preservation, which a lot of my work also then moves into evolution and the decline of species or the extinction of species. So with this work, I reflect on how we as human species no longer have an underlying, an understanding of our place within the greater scheme of life. That's, it's about 20 something feet wide. I didn't have time to fade this one. Okay. And then the last project, it is circumsolar migration. Circumsolar focuses on migration. And as I've been talking a while back, is something that, as an immigrant myself, the idea of having kind of moved away from one place and that you then either establish your location somewhere else or you continue doing the cycles of migration, it is something that I'm very interested in focusing, not only as the migration, the social issues of migration that we're encountering, but also, you know, again, artists, scientists, presidents, all of us, that we establish our migratory patterns. So that, again, is like bringing a little bit of more of the time element into the material. So Circumsolar is a long-term project that is based on the Arctic tern, a very small seabird that does the longest migration of all living things. They've tested, they've mapped everything, so many birds, so many things, but this one was only able to be chipped about maybe 6 years ago. And the amount of the travel that they do is twice what they thought. It really is the longest migration recorded in all beings. It goes from the Arctic to the Antarctic and back again every year. It experiences two polar summers of 24-hour daylight each year, and therefore it also makes the one creature in the world that lives the most daylight. And I think that, to me alone, just the idea that it is constantly pursuing the sun is something that is very poetic. This is that picture. This is captured in Iceland in its boreal summer, which is where it's nesting. So the entire voyage is kind of summarized in this poem that I can very I can read, or you can read, but maybe for the audience I will. But I don't think I can move this down. It's a solo flight from the Arctic to the Antarctic and back again. Boreal summer to austral summer, close to 300 miles a day, a year total of 50,000 miles. Leave the Arctic in August and travel for 80 days south. Fuel up on food in the mid-Atlantic. Clear the North Sea, pass the Azores, comb the west coast of Africa, traverse the east coast of Brazil, and arrive in the Great Southern Ocean at the edge of the melting polar drift ice. Mold feathers, the flight feathers, and feast on krill for 150 days, circumnavigate the Antarctic continent, leave in April, and soar with the westerlies to travel 40 days north, over Tristan de Acuña, Santa Elena, and Asunción. Pass the equator and catch the trade winds to return to the Arctic in June to breed. 80 days later, as the days grow shorter, take flight south again for the Arctic turn to live the most daylight of any creature in the world. So one of the things that interests me about this project is that not only, again, as I talked about migration, but here is where we began investigating about the bird. We connected with a scientist, Freydis, who is the utmost scientist of the Arctic tern, and she shared with us that 90% of the chicks are dying since 2012 of starvation. And this is simply because the waters around Iceland have warmed up by 1 degree, which brings the mackerel sooner and eats the sand eel, which is the only food for that the Arctic tern chicks can eat. Their beaks are so tiny. And of course, it's the thing that they are known to be able to bring the parents to the chicks. I documented, I did very, very rigorous field work that it's still in the works. We're making a book of all of these research and findings. And what was sad to see is that as I was filming, I saw, I spent about maybe 2 weeks in a specific colony, and I saw the parents feeding, not only trying to feed the wrong bird to the little chick so that they would kind of see this little fat little bird and they did not know what to do. They peck at it and then they simply ran away. And then the parents making the decision of then starting to feed only one of the couple of the two birds, because all of them have one or two eggs, and that you knew at that moment that the parents were choosing which one was going to survive. So it's very, very, to us, is the canary in the coal mine, in which we know that when we are looking at these birds, the ecological disasters that are happening because of the Anthropocene climate change are very real. So as we're looking at that, we are documenting this because we believe that this might be a species that might be getting close to extinction. So it is our symbol, it is our bird with which we tell the story, the larger story that has to do with the Anthropocene climate change. So our project, and I'm not gonna go into the details, but the project is a long-term project that will go from the Arctic to the Antarctic. We're gonna follow the bird's trajectory and make field work, document, collaborate with scientists to be able to understand what exactly is happening on each stage and what are the consequences of the climate changes on one species alone. This one, this work will join the project that Maya Lin started that is called What is Missing, in which she started a very, very ambitious last memorial, that she calls it, in which all of the records of species that are in decline are being sent and are being joined into this Collective Global Library, which is an amazing project that she's doing. And so this next project is just the first phase of the project, the first work of this large project, is the one that was exhibited at GLOW. It is a single channel video that is 26 minutes and focuses on the boreal summer, the breeding season, May, June, and July of this little creature. This is an installation at GLOW, which is a night's art event in Santa Monica, California, where for about 12 hours, five artists that were selected from around the world show their artwork. They commission the city of Santa Monica and GLOW commission five artists. They give you the budget to be able to then create one artwork for 12 hours. It was insane, intense. I wish it would last a little bit longer because it really felt like the efforts were enormous. 130,000 people attended the event, so at least we know that it was viewed. And this is another point of view. So we work with engineers, we work with, because especially in Santa Monica, the Santa Ana wind sometimes happened during that time of the year, and we knew that this would be a sail that could just fly away. So we had to, you'll see a little bit of how it was built. I have a short video of that. But what was interesting to me was that this kind of idea of the false transparency happened. I was not expecting this. When I began projecting at the hour that we were all to start, the sun had not completely set. And it was, for a public art, it was a nice thing to see that, you know, people began gathering around it, but that also we had at one point like 100 pelicans going behind and that they, you know, intersected the screen. Happened with a lot of this interest in the environment, in the ecology that we create and that we inhabit, and where things are going. We are connecting with the environmental humanities here at UCLA, and we're definitely excited about what is going to happen in relation to our involvement with the Institute for Environment and Sustainability. So again, I think that with the Arctic Tern at its core, the work investigates larger themes relevant to our time, such as the social issue of migration, both human and animal, the ecological concern of the Anthropocene climate change, and the geopolitics of the Arctic and the Antarctic. What I'll do is that I'm going to just put a few minutes of this work, of the last project. And again, that to me is like the work. The intention of the work emerges from the experience of the physical encounter with the natural forces that govern our planet in order to understand a better way of how is our place within it. So I am going to again escape now from this. And those, what was, let me just see here. We've done that. I think it's right here. Okay, thank you. There, thank you. The perspective makes me not be able to see anything. An arc to the work that it takes you from the forces that enable the migration to a moment of nesting to a moment of leaving, so that there is in 26 minutes you go through an evolution of the work. And I know that maybe I can put the volume down if you have any questions, we can address them as we see the work. Questions. The sound of the work is by Ben Frost, and we collaborate in the work. I think that again the kind of force that he brings to the work, but at the same time is not cinematic, but is much more about creating an atmosphere that is of the work, because I think that always the question of sound comes up, like when is it that you, what kind of sound do you do to the work? Does the sound guide? Is the sound dominating? I think that those are questions that I have gotten quite a bit in lectures. And I think that definitely with the sound, I do guide, but primarily I try to guide towards the nature of the material you're looking at, rather than telling you to go into a mental space, a solely mental space. Hopefully I'm taking you to a material space. Yeah, always the sound, my sound composers, they receive all my field recordings. Okay. The sound emerges from there. So if it is, for example, the sun, we are working with the sun, the energy that's been recorded from NASA of what the sound that the sun emits. Okay. When it is, for example, the waterfalls or anything, then I record them and then I give that. Even the birds themselves, when you were seeing the work of the vertical birds, that sound is done by Drew Schnur, which is a local composer and who used to teach sound here. It is based on the Arctic Tern's peeps. Now, to leave the actual sound is something that, as you saw, the very, very first work, it is something that I am doing work that also just allows for the sound to be a player in the work by itself.
Are you projecting those from the
always
film, or
projecting.
Is it digital?
Oh no, you know, it is digital. The film hasn't been output into back again into film. That would be my ideal. Yep, because then you do have the presence of the material. But it is something that almost no museum, no gallery has either the funds, or so far they haven't had the funds to be able to do that. But that would be my ideal, to output the work back in 16 millimeter. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I came in late. Sorry, that was a really slow bus. But when I came in, there was the photograph of the jungle,
yeah,
the Mayan rune. And I was just curious, all the work that I saw after that had long horizon points, but there was a very short horizon. Yeah,
and I think that kind of, I was talking a little bit about the way in which that enclosure, that sense of the jungle being completely like on you is how, and Mexico City, it's like two completely hyper complex on your face kind of environments. So when I moved into exploring this vastness, it's because for me it's the unknown, it's that which is new to me. Therefore, I really see it more carefully. Now I'm going back to the jungle. Like I spent this summer deep in the jungles of Mexico, and it reminded me of what I love about those places, that you definitely sense that intensity and imminence. I mean, I think that I feel it in both, but they're such different environments. As we will be following the Arctic turn, some of the environments are tropical. So we, even though the bird is pelagic, so it does not like being around humans or the land, we will be going in and out from places that will be like, for example, I think in Asunción or Tristan da Cunha, those islands will be incredibly tropical. So the work itself will tell us what we need to shoot, and we will inhabit those spaces and work from there. But I had forgotten how you have to, as soon as you go somewhere, you tuckle your pants, you put, you know, everything so no bug can get into you, and it's such a different thing. There, weather will kill you, or your own mind, but, well, a polar bear in that moment, but Iceland or some of those places, they are so, they're so easy to, you can do a 24-hour walk, and, you know, and really the only thing that will kill you would be the weather. So it's interesting how, you know, looking at insects and looking at the weather at the same kind of the natural part of the natural world that can actually overcome you. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
We had seen where, you know, it's, there's the black room, everything's mapped to the wall, and very stark. I don't know why you make those choices.
You know, I think that part of me wants to make a way with the room and to have a sense of extension of the space. I think that I have not had the interest into actually bringing the space to the foreground. So, because I was focusing primarily on the natural phenomena. Now that in the first work where I am including the urban space, it would only make sense that this exhibition has to be considering the built environment. So I'm excited, I'm looking forward to that, because I think that the idea of doing the work that deals much more with the multiplicity of projection of space, of even the way in which one perhaps sees the work, is completely different to what I have done. I mean, I have done very singular kind of, I want you to focus on the elements that I'm doing within it, and the rest should disappear, or the rest should be a material that you relate to, or that you notice, get immersed in that, both material and light. Mm-hmm. I know, yeah. And that's, it's difficult, because there's times, to me, the ideal work, the ideal way is an immersive space. And so there's times that people have wanted to, or they want to exhibit the work. Like when it was exhibited at the Hammer Museum, it was on screens. And then what happens to the work? So it's not a place, a work that you inhabit, but it is a work that you then encounter as a screen. And I think that in the case of my work, it takes away what my ideal is. I do want you to have a sense that one of the things that Steve Nolan said, that when the, which is a curator at the Williamson Gallery, and he, when I have this piece, or when I had the one of the grass and the wood and the waterfall and the lava, was that people would actually go in there, and then they would sit down and have their lunch there. Like if they would work there, people would actually use it almost like a meditative room, which is wonderful. I think that kind of inhabiting is nice. Taking your time with my work matters. So when you're looking at it in a screen, it's the thing that you can just kind of, oh, okay, I can just move. So I'm not able to actually have the experience that I want to have. So yeah, I have chosen not to exhibit in many places because they don't have the capacity to do so. Did that answer that question? And for example, here, this shot to me, the one that is seeking, is the idea that simply we think we understand not only each other, but we think we understand the environment, but we get glimpses of it. We just have a moment of a grasp of something, and it eludes us. Yeah. And this existed here first. And I chose to then take it out and do a full screen of that. And I think I've kept you here long enough. So anything else? Any last question anyone has? Okay. I love the desert. It is to me the same nothingness. Yeah, no, it is. I learned to like the desert. One of the first times that I encountered the desert was basically taking my little Volkswagen Bug from Mexico City and just driving through the Chihuahuan Desert, then the Sonora Desert, into Los Angeles. And I love it. We did work in the desert of Atacama, the driest place on earth. And yeah, I'm fascinated with that same sense of void, of the idea of space. How, as you go through it, you don't have enough weight to be able to turn it into place. It's as if then you float, because there's no sense of place. It's simply space. And that spatial infinity is incredible. Yeah, very powerful. Love it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.